church say amen.
Amen.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, it's good to see you today, brothers and sisters, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I just feel it in my heart that somebody's here for the very first time. I feel it in my spirit. The Lord has put it in my spirit that somebody's here for the very first time. You may not be here for the very first time physically, but you're here for the very first time spiritually. You're here for the very first time. Amen. This may be Father's Day. Amen. I got a loud voice. I don't typically use one of these things, but I'll use it today. You're here for the very first time. Happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day. Amen. Real, real, Jesus is real to me. Oh, yes, he gives me the victory. So many people doubt him, but I can't live without him. And that is why I love him so, because he's so real to me. Real, real, Jesus is real to me. Oh, yes, he gives me the victory. So many people doubt him, but I can't live without him. And that is why I love him so, because he's so real to me. Thank you, Jesus. Let's give the Lord a big hand clap. Hallelujah! 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. When I was asked to do the Father's Day message, I kind of like, my stomach got cold. I said, But I still said yes. I still said yes. I said me, and I got kind of weary, but I said okay, yes. The word tells me to be ready in season and out of season. Hallelujah. In season, out of season. I have a special brother who tended here to me. We talk on a regular basis. He's my brother, Brother Steve, and my sister, Margaret. God bless you. I'm so happy to see your faces out there today. You know, Pastor Warren came up and he shared about revival. We need a revival in the church today. We need a revival in the church today. Hallelujah. And we need encouragement. You know, I needed some encouragement coming into this message today. I needed some encouragement, and I kept telling my wife, I said, boy, I could use a little encouragement. You know, when you're called to do a great task for the Lord, you begin to wonder, Lord, what do you want me to do? And you know that the Lord did for me? He sent the church right to my residence. That's the God we serve. He sent the church right to my residence. Some of you may say, what are you talking about? Let me tell you what I'm talking about. I was outside yesterday, and I was working on my car, and the church showed up. The church literally showed up. It literally parked right next to my car. Hello, Deacon Walter. It's the church. And the car was loaded. And they said, are you ready to preach tomorrow? Yeah. They said, be encouraged. You get out of the way and let the Holy Spirit have his way, and everything will work out fine. Thank you, sister, for letting the Lord use you. Thank you, brother, for being an encouragement in my life. Thank you, Pastor Martin, for being an encouragement in my life. Me and Pastor Warren were just talking about that. The church needs to encourage the church. As iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. So we're here to talk about Father's Day, but we cannot even begin to get into Father's Day of earthly fathers without first acknowledging our real Father who is in heaven. I wouldn't even begin to try to talk about anything related to being Father unless I acknowledge my great Father who is in heaven. Amen? Amen. Our great Father who is in heaven. Now, I have something to say. Yes, God is the Father of all creation. And he is the Father of all creation. And I want to share with you today this great message. And I would like all of you to recite with me the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus taught us to pray that prayer. Jesus taught us to pray that prayer in the most words that stand out to me. Not that they all don't, but the words that really stand out to me today is the first few words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Hallowed be thy name says to me that there is no other name. That name is hollowed out. It stands in a place where you have no idea. It's holy. I'm looking for a word, Pastor. It's great. It's everything. It existed before the world even existed. The Bible tells me that the Spirit of the Lord, it hovered over the waters before the earth was even formed. I'm amazed at God. I'm amazed at how great our Father is. Amen. And some of us don't even, people don't even acknowledge him for that today. They don't acknowledge that. First of all, let me put on my other eyes. Hallelujah. Leave me alone. Some of you have that same thing going. See, I have, at home, believe it or not, at home I have like four pair of glasses. Ask my wife, she'll tell you, and she'll catch me. I'll have one set up here, and I'll have the other set on my face. And I'm in the computer room, Pastor Varney, and I look, it's crazy. She comes in, and she cracks up. She said, look at you. I said, well, these are my computer glasses, these are my reading glasses, and these are my seeing glasses. So I hope I got the right glasses today. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You know, our Creator, it's a great thing, you know, when we're just sharing about the Lord, you know what I mean, God as our Creator. I just want to read with you a few things, you know, about God being our Creator. You know, God is the Creator of everything. You know, he is the Creator of all that is. One of the many passages to proclaim God as our Creator is in Isaiah 40, chapter 40, verse 28. You know what I mean? And it's an amazing thing. It says, have you not known, have you not heard that the Lord is the everlasting God, the creators of the earth and the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. Do you not know and have you not heard? Amen. All three persons in the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. A creator is someone who makes something new. People cannot create anything. People cannot create anything. Art projects, musical compositions, physical structures. However, there always have to be something to work with. We as people always have to have something to work with. They begin with pre-existing matter and form it into new ways. Even music and other intellectual creations have rhythms and other things like that. But when it comes to God, our Father, he doesn't need anything. He just speaks it, and it comes into existence. He just speak it, and it comes into existence. He don't have anything to work with. All he has to do is speak it, and it is so. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? Isn't it amazing? See, I'm bringing to your enlightenment God our Father. Because, see, we don't have nothing until we understand who he is, until we have a relationship with him. Amen. Genesis 1:1 says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And that means that before there existed no heaven and no earth, God spoke them into being. In 6 days, the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that was in them. Amen. The Lord has made the heavens and the earth and everything, for he is God. He is not limited by our understanding, nor time, space, or matter. As the creator, God is the all-wise originator and the designer of all things. Amen. All things. How many are your works, Lord? In wisdom, you made them all. It reads in Psalms 104. Hallelujah. When God created the heavens and the earth, he did so by speaking it into existence once again. And when he created the things that filled the earth and the sky, he spoke them into being, church. And when he created human beings, he did something different. Listen to this. He took some dust from the ground that he had already made, and he formed a man. This is the part that I really want to... He formed a man. He formed a man. It's something about the man that God formed that has a special position with God. Something about the man. He made the man first. Ladies, don't start throwing nothing at me. He made the man. Because he made the man because in his own image. He didn't just make him to make him. He made him in his own image and the likeness of him. In his likeness, which means he has things like God in him. And he breathes his own breath into this man. His DNA is in this man. He puts it in this man, and the man comes to life. That's amazing. I'm talking to you, men. You men. We've all been made in the likeness of God. I don't care who you think you are or where you think you're from or who your earthly father is, but you've been created in the likeness of God. And it's important that you understand that today. It's important that you understand your creator, who is God the Father. Happy Father's Day. When God created this man, he breathed into his lungs. And that man became a living soul. And he created the first woman, who is Eve. He takes one of the man's ribs, and he makes that woman. She becomes woman, a part of a man. So when I talk about mankind, I'm talking to you too, sisters. Each and every one of us. Happy Father's Day. For many of you mothers out there have been fathers too. Let's just face it. If you're anything like my mother, you've been a father too. So this is to you too. Amen. God is the designer of everything, you know, and he makes everything, you know. God is the designer and the craftsman. He brings human beings a step above all the rest by breathing his own life into that man. He created man and a woman in his own image. That means that human beings are more like God than any other created thing. We have an eternal spirit just as God has. We can reason. We can choose. We can choose evil and love. We have emotions, intellect, and power, and the desire to create things ourselves. God desires to have fellowship with us. He desires this. He does not seek fellowship with dogs and dolphins and trees. Only humans does God seek this desired relationship with. Only humans. And when he came to earth to save us, he came in the form of a man. He came in the form of a man. So when we say that God is our creator, we mean that no one created him and that God alone is the creator of all things. And if you have a relationship with God through his son Jesus, then you can cry out, Abba, Father. See, there's a difference between God being the creator of all things and you having that the blessed assurance, if you know his son, to call him Abba Father. The word Abba means I have an intimate relationship with God. Amen. You have an intimate relationship, Brother Joe. You know him personally. Amen. You don't just come to church and hear about him. You don't walk out and Monday through Friday skip throw to life doing what you want to do. You have an intimate relationship with him. You know him for yourself. See, you've experienced God for yourself. Each and every one of us in here must have an experience with God for yourself. Because when we come to the throne one day, you ain't going to be able to bring your kids with you. You ain't going to be able to bring your husband or your wife with you. You ain't going to be able to bring your cat or your dog. No advocates. It's just going to be you and him. See this I know. Hallelujah. We say that God created everything. We must start with forming a relationship with him. And because he created everything belongs to him. Everything belongs to him. You belong to him. You belong to him. You may think that you're doing things on your own accord or doing things that you want to do it, how you want to do it, where you want to do it, in the fashion that you want to do it. But you belong to God. You belong to him. He created you. He created you. Hallelujah. Now, I want to say this to say that yes, God is the creator of all things, but yet, not everybody is a child of God. I shared that with somebody today, and do you know that they got so upset? And people are running around today, they're saying, we're all God's children. We're all God's children. We're all God's children. Well, I hate to break the ice or break the news, but we are not all God's children. We are not all God's children. Long shot for it. But the Bible tells me that God has his children, and then there's children of devil. Huh? So if you're misconstrued on that right there and you're running around after service and you want to do whatever you want to do and you want to do it the way you want to do it and you want to be disobedient to according to this word, let me tell you something. You're about as far as from God as I am from Egypt. And I don't want to rattle your feathers, but you need to know this today, that if you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus, well, you're as far as from God than anything. Pastor said that we need to speak Jesus and we need to get radical sometimes when it comes to sharing Christ. We were just sharing that. And I hope that today, by time we all leave here, we are reestablished or seeking a new commitment to follow the Lord. Amen. Don't just come to church because your wife asked you to. Don't just come to church because it's Father's Day. Come to church because Jesus is probing at your heart. Come to church because you know this is your rightful place, is to be established with the Lord. Happy Father's Day. Well, I wish I would have came in here all giddy and happy. I came in here because I know that the Lord has called me to establish even a newer and better relationship with my Father, who is him. Amen. So who are the sons of God? Who are the children of God? Who are these sons and daughters of God? They are men and women who have entered a covenant with God. They've entered a relationship with God. We've got on our knees and we repented. When God began to work on the man's heart, let me tell you something, no one can come to the Son lest the Father draws him. Men, I'm talking to you, men. Us men, we have this thing, this machismo thing, where we think that our way is the right way. We have this thing where some men, you know, they think we're self-made. We think we're doing it on our own. We've been dealt some bad cards in life. We've been dealt some trauma. We've been through some things. And so therefore we seek to establish ourselves. We've shut the door on a whole lot of things. We've shut the door on forgiveness. We've shut the door on anything else because we made a confession that we won't let that happen again. I know because I was one of them. Until the Lord began to work on my heart. He said, harden not your heart. Harden not your heart, Walter. I've been in prison, I don't know how many years. Me and the pastor were talking the other day, and we went as far as back, out on Route 6, the old Brooklyn jail. When he was pastoring it up there, and I said, man, I think I remember you. Isn't that something? Been doing time since the early 90s, Pastor Warren, just doing time. That old repeated cycle. Anybody in here ever do any time? You know what I'm talking about. I'm not ashamed. What you see standing before you is a miracle. You see a miracle standing before you. If you've never seen a miracle, look up here. Go look in the mirror. You'll see a miracle. When you're looking at me, you're looking at a miracle. Hallelujah. I don't know how that woman downstairs did it, but it's only by the grace of God that she's still here with me today. Because I took her through the ringer. I took her through the ringer, the poor child, chasing me all over the place. Drug houses, everywhere else. But she just wouldn't give up. Don't mind me. That always takes me to an emotional place. But she just didn't give up. Some of us have been there. Somebody knows exactly what I'm talking about. It may not have been drugs for you. It may not have been that for you. But it may have been something else for you. Men, particularly I'm talking to today, we have to show that we're not soft. We have to show that we don't cry. We have to show that we're not weak. And so we have this perception where I need to be strong in every area that, you know, all these things. But when it comes to Jesus, when it comes to having a relationship with the Lord, you must be weak. You must confess your weaknesses. You must acknowledge your weaknesses. You must know that I cannot do this. You must get on your knees, just like that brother said. Get on your knees. Snot, tears, all that. And confess, Lord, I can't do this, and I need you, Jesus. And invite him in your heart. And let me tell you something. When Jesus touches a man, you'll want him to touch him. You'll want him to touch you all over again. When Jesus picks up the dirt, spits in it, puts it all together and rubs it on the man's eyes, and he begins to see. There's nothing like that. There's nothing like it. So who are the children of God? They are the people who have given up living selfishly for their own pleasure and pursuits. They decided to follow Jesus in a life of sacrifice and salvation. God's Spirit dwells in them, giving them power to resist evil and to pursue good. These are the children of God. They are obedient to God's voice and follow his commands. They, like Moses as a young man, chose to suffer rather than to enjoy the pleasures of Egypt. Moses turned his back in honor, riches, and easy, and the leisure life, and he chose to serve God with his people. Amen. It says in Hebrews 11:24, by faith, Moses, when he became of age, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin, esteeming the reproach of Christ rather than the riches and the treasures of this world. Some of us have to be ready to live our lives for Jesus. and not for the world. The true children of God do the same, and they're separate. They cannot do and watch everything that is mainstream and keep company with just anybody. They want to keep their hearts pure from corruption in this world and do not want to displease God, their loving Father. The suffering of denying their self-will is only mandatory, and it leads to peace, joy, and victory. So, men, I'm asking you today, do you have a relationship with Jesus? Do you have a relationship with Jesus? See, you may have children. You may have a wife and you may have children. But this is what the Lord told me. Until you are established in Christ, until you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, and you become a child, well, you're not ready to be a father. I might sound kind of ironic to some of you, but it's true. Because until we are under the authority of Jesus Christ, we don't have victory. We don't have authority until we are under the authority of Jesus Christ. That makes sense? Under the authority of Jesus Christ, walking under the anointing of his Spirit, that thee can be empowered by his Spirit to be the men who God has called us to be. Amen. Amen. We have to be under the anointing. We have to be submissive to the Spirit. We have to come with broken and contrite hearts. We have to be broken. Until we're broken, men, I'm talking to you, he'll never be able to fix us and use us to be the men he's called us to be. Amen. To be a loving husband to our wives. Amen. It has to be the attributes of Christ that are flowing through us. Amen. Pastor Vonnie, it has to be the love of Jesus flowing through us into our family, into our children, into our wives, into that. Everything that Jesus is pouring into us, it comes out. These are the fruits of the Spirit. How do I know that's true? Because I have two children. I have three. I have older kids. I have a son that's 35. I have a daughter that's 30. And to this very day, they don't speak to me. They don't speak to me. My son speaks to me every now and then. My daughter, she will not speak to me. I tell on myself because Jesus is greater. Jesus is greater than the pain. Jesus is greater than the hurt. I pled with Charlene. I said, I don't know why she won't talk to me. For years, I cried out to her. I spoke to her. I told her I was sorry for everything I ever did, everything I ever said, every lie I ever told. She won't talk to me, church. She won't. That hurts. She looks just like Rihanna. She's beautiful. She won't talk to me. But I just keep praying for reconciliation, reestablishment in relationships. Jesus is a healer of all broken things. You know why I know that? Because he's healing my heart. He's healing my heart. But because God is so good, he's so good, and we have a good, good Father, and I accepted Jesus as my Lord and my Savior. And I said, Lord, lead me in the path of righteousness. You know what he did? He allowed me to be a daddy again. I got a 2-year-old downstairs. You know what she called me? Daddy. Daddy. That's the first time I ever can experience that. The very first time. Daddy. And let me tell you something. There's something about daddy that does something to a man. That just does something to a man. It does. It does something to this man. I don't know about you men, but it does something to this man. When that little face comes running up, and she's looking for me to help her, whatever the situation might be, whatever the cry might be, whether she bumped her leg, whether she hurt her hand, she's coming to daddy. And God has made me a new creation. that every cry she cries, that I can be right there to answer her. And it's all through Jesus Christ. When the phone rings, I pick it up. I don't know those times when I was able to do that before. But today I'm able to do that. Praise the Lord. Today I'm able to do that. Praise the Lord. I had to share that with you. You know, some of you in here today, let me just get my notes here, what I had. Some of you are here today have been through brokenness. Some of us have fathers, not the best relationships with some of our dads, man. I had a pretty rocky relationship with my dad. I didn't know him for long. He died when I was 13. He died, man. I was a young man taking care of my dad. He was an alcoholic. Anybody who's a native of Norwich, remember Yana's Package Store? Old Dunkin' Donuts above, down below School Street. Lisa, you remember that. You knew my dad very well. Waldo. Waldo, there he is. Drunk on the city stairs. She'll tell you that on those city stairs, you'd walk up the city stairs and you would walk through a line of alcoholics. There's a line of them. Am I lying? A line of them. And you'd walk up there, and my daddy, he'd be right out there. And the first thing he would yell, "That's my son!" I was ashamed that he would say that, because all the other kids on the school bus would be there. "Don't say that." And they'd laugh at him, and let me tell you something. When they laughed at him, I went fighting. Don't laugh at my dad. He makes me mad that I got to defend him at such a young age. That's how I became fighting for his honor. Urinating all over himself, all that stuff. It was a bad trip for me. It was a bad time for me, you know. I'll never forget that somebody shared about their dad. That moment, he used to go into these seizures. He's had grandma seizures, these harsh seizures, and I would be little. My mom would send me up to see him sometime, and he'd fall out shaking all over the place, and I would just sit there and look at him, didn't know what to do, but he'd finally come through. But one time he had one, and I said, "I'm not getting in that ambulance." That's the day he died. That's the day he died. And for many years of my life, I dealt with the horror of not being able to say something to him. Today, I understand what he was going through. He watched his mother get murdered. He watched his mother be killed right in front of him. And he dealt with it through a bottle. That's how he dealt with it. And today, I understand. I wish I knew today what I didn't know back then, because I would tell him that Jesus loved you. I really do. And if there's some of you in here today who have a bad relationship and you're still able to go speak to those loved ones, go tell them Jesus loved you, and I love you too, and I forgive you, and it's okay, and it's all right that I love you. Because unless you forgive him, the Lord will not forgive you. You gotta go forgive him. If you're gonna follow Jesus, men, you men in the back, and you got a broken relationship with your dad, or you got something going on where you think you just don't have to deal with this person in your life, and you can just shut them off, and you can crucify them, and you can put them on the wall anytime you're having an emotional shipwreck, and you think that you can throw darts at that person, well, you're in a bad position, because Jesus does not accept that. He does not accept that. In order to follow Jesus, you must have the first thing, the qualification of following Jesus, is you must have forgiveness. And you must be full of mercy. For he was merciful to you. Amen. I'm getting a little off beat here, but it's important. The Holy Spirit is just leading me to speak that to you today. Happy Father's Day. We can't be fathers not forgiving our fathers. Forgive them. Forgive them. That way you can move forward and walk in with the Lord. Amen. Because when we forgive, he forgives us. We're reestablished in Christ. Our relationship with the Lord is just that much better when we forgive. When we forgive, huh? We can't even go to the Lord in prayer with unforgiveness in our hearts. We can't even do that. You think you can talk to the Lord with unforgiveness in your heart? Let me wake you up to something. Well, you can't. Well, you can't. Because he says, if you come to me and you have an ought with your brethren, leave it at the altar. Leave it right there and go fix it. Then come back. Let me tell you something. Love covers a multitude of sin. Love covers it. Love heals it. Love delivers it. And I went and I said, Daddy, I love you. I love you. And I wish you were here that I could tell you that I love you. Don't walk around with bitterness in your heart. Make it a happy Father's Day today. Be a father that the Lord wants you to be. We don't have to walk in the footsteps of those who may have traumatized us or hurt us. Be who the Lord has called you to be today, men. Be who the Lord calls you to be. Don't sit there and put on the pity pot and say, I've been dealt a bad hand. I've been dealt this. Oh, you don't understand. Oh, this. Get off that. Jesus has washed it away. Jesus has washed it away. Hallelujah. I know somebody here knows exactly what I'm talking about. I know somebody here knows exactly what I'm talking about. And I just want to say, God bless you mothers who have been fathers too. God bless you mothers. You know, Sister Nancy preached a good message about Mother's Day. I was a mama's boy. Let me just say that. Woo-hoo to the ladies and all you mothers in here. For you have been fathers too when we were not filling our position and our role as fathers. But let me tell you something. Be more than a father and be a daddy today. Be more than just a father. Any man can father a child. Any man can go out and father a child. But it takes a godly man to be daddy. It takes a Holy Spirit-filled man to be daddy, to earn that role to be called dad. That's my dad. You know, the children are an inheritance of the Lord. That's my dad, man. I love him. I love everything about him. Instead of my father here. I love the fact that my little girl calls me daddy today. And if you want to be called daddy, work on that today by giving the Lord your heart. Confess your sins. Open your heart to Jesus and receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior today. Before you leave this place, give your heart to Jesus. Now, I just want to talk to you before we come into closing about a couple small things. I want to talk about a couple men in the Bible. I won't talk about five, but I want to talk about a couple men in the Bible. Some men who are a great inspiration, who had some moments in their life, transformative moments. Oh, back in the Old Testament, we read about Enoch, you know. We read about Enoch. Amen. Enoch, a wonderful man in the Bible, you know what I mean? He loved the Lord, but it says that when Enoch had lived 65 years, he became the father of Methuselah. Amen. Of Methuselah. And Enoch walked with God after the birth of Methuselah. You see the transformative moment in Enoch's life. He walked with the Lord. But it was something that empowered him when his son was born. He even walked that much closer with the Lord. Amen. Enoch walked with God at the birth of Methuselah 300 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Enoch were 365. Enoch walked with God. Then he was no more because God had took him. These transformative moments. Sometimes it takes something to transform us. Some type of epiphany, whatever you want to call it, that just makes you wake up. Maybe God is probing at your heart today with the message to make you seek a better relationship with him. Because let me tell you something, When you submit unto God, he can move through you, and that relationships can be restored. He's doing it in me because I don't hold no more bitterness towards my kids. I don't hold no more. I don't understand why they do what they do. You know what I do? I pray for them and I love them. And I tell my wife, whenever the day might come that the Lord should open it and they come back, I'm going to be right here at their every beck and need that they need me for. You better believe it. Some say, but you absolutely right, I would. If they need anything, they can come to me. And I put it out there. Whether they respond or not, I need you to know that I love you. Amen. You know, after the first child of Enoch, he made a decision to walk with God. Perhaps his relationship with God was similar to a distant, dutiful, ritualistic, quiet time. Whatever it was like, after the birth of his son, Enoch took it to another level. Something about the responsibility for a new life transformed his spiritual life. Amen. Transform his spiritual life. Amen. Now I just want to talk about one more. I want to talk about Abraham. I want to talk about Abraham, who had a spiritual mindset. It says, by faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. He set out not knowing where he was going, Hebrews 11, chapter 8. By this is the reason that faith is the single source of the promise, so that grace would be offered to all Abraham's children. Those whose lives are defined by the law and those who follow the path of faith charted by Abraham, our common father. Amen. Abraham had a spiritual mindset. We are adopting a spiritual mindset when we chart our path by faith. This spiritual mindset is one when we are unintimidated by the obstacles we see, because our focus is on the unseen presence and the power of God that was with us. This faith in God is the source of our confidence, men, making us bold rather than timid. Risk tolerance and walk in faith other than fear. Some of us have a mindset, gentlemen, that it is what it is. If you don't have an established relationship with your children, then it just is what it is. Oh, so be it. I think that if we get more closer in Jesus in prayer, and like the brother said, a revival for us men, that relationships can be restored. Relationships can be healed. I have a young man, a young 17. He's my stepson. Some of us are stepfathers in here too. We're not all biological dad. There's some stepfathers in here. There's some godfathers in here. There's some grandfathers in here. And I believe that when we get more established in Christ, the more established in Christ we become, the more power we receive from him. The more we come down in repentance, the more God can break us of our old behaviors, and that we can be walking in the anointing of his spirit. Happy Father's Day. So I'm calling out for anybody who's here today who may have a need. Maybe you're a Christian, maybe you've already given your life to Christ, but yet at home you have a horrible relationship with your children. You have a bad relationship with your children. Some children you've cut off. You just don't deal with them. If you're like me, I've done that. Maybe you're a new expecting father, waiting to be your father. Let me tell you something. Without Jesus, all you do is going to fail. It really is. Everything you do is going to fail. Everything you go through, everything you think that you're establishing, whether I don't care if you're making great figures at your job, everything you do is going to fail without Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Man of God, you must be under the authority of Jesus Christ. You must have a relationship. You must have a relationship with Jesus first before you hope to have any kind of successful relationship with your children. The man has been called to be the spiritual leader over his household. The spiritual leader of his household. Not our sisters. The man has been called to be the spiritual leader over our household. He is supposed to bring things together and prayer. I'm the man in my house. I'm the man in my house. I pay the bills. But yet you don't even know Jesus. What kind of man are you? Get a relationship with Jesus Christ. Establish a relationship with Jesus Christ, and he will show you everything you need to do walking with the Lord through the power of his Spirit. This word right here is instructions on how to be the man that God has called us to be. Everything he's called us to be is right here in his word. This is the living word. This word is living. This is not your run-of-the-mill typical book. This is the living word of God, the enduring word of God. It stands forever. It endures forever. It is a light unto your path and a lamp unto your feet when you're lost. And you need direction and you need guidance. You're going to find it in the word. And the word is Jesus. Amen. So at this time, I'm just going to ask if there's anybody who just wants to come up for prayer or need prayer or need to be reestablished in the faith, who needs the Lord to just speak to their heart, just need some encouragement, need your faith to be renewed. I know I do, constantly. As Brother Steve, Pastor Varney, Pastor Randy, all the time, pray for me. You know, pray for me. I'm in need of prayer. It's not the people down the street or those out there, right? It's me, oh Lord, I need prayer. It's me. I'm the one broken. I need it. I need the Lord. I can't do nothing without it. I talk to Pastor Martin all the time. He's always encouraging me. Sometimes I'm broken. Sometimes I'm all messed up, Brother Joe. Because the world, it's not easy. My wife will tell you, it's not easy for me sometimes. I get weary. I get weary. I say, Lord, I've never come this far before. But the word says, you've brought me this far by faith. And he has not brought me this far to leave me. He has not brought me this far to leave me. See, my mom and my father, they've gone on to be with the Lord. So I turn to you guys now. You're my brothers and you're my sisters. I turn to the church, my church family. Yes, you, my brother right there. He encouraged me all the time. I love that man. And I just want to say, if you're like me, young people, new dads, happy Father's Day. Come on up and receive prayer today. Come on up and receive the Lord today. Don't walk out of this church not having Jesus Christ in your life. Amen, Pastor Randy. So with that, I'm just going to say God bless you. Happy Father's Day. And we're going to have an altar call, but I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Randy. And God bless you, and the Lord keep you.